We would like for you to welcome now our speaker this afternoon, Brother Rick Manis. He's come to us this time from Florida. We've known each other for a long time, haven't we, Brother
Rick?
All right. Rick, you have your liberty. Take your liberty. You can either use that mic or a handheld, whichever one you prefer.
I'll take a handheld. There you go. Old fashioned. All right. Hey, guys.
Hi.
We're going to have some fun this
afternoon. Amen.
And tonight and tomorrow. I'm going to be reading out of 2 Corinthians 3. Start out if you want to follow me in your Bible. While you're doing that, we do have our feast of good stuff over there on the table. We've got some t-shirts, fullness t-shirts, always on full t-shirts, blue, black, pink, take your pick. All of my books are on the table. You know, the first book I wrote was called Fullness. Anybody here ever read that book?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody not read it? Oh, you gotta get it. It's really, it begins talking about a change that started happening to me about 15 years ago. And I've been in the ministry over 30 years and have loved Jesus since the day I met him, April of 1979. But, you know, in our Christianity, in our walk, there are so many things that we can talk about in this thick book called the Bible, and all the scripture is profitable to us, but we have to rightly divide it. And I didn't know how to rightly divide it for a long time, not in the way that I want to talk about this morning, this afternoon. But I found myself, I come to the end of myself, and this is all in the first chapter of the book there, if you've read it. But I was a Christian who was very strong in so many ways, and I seemed to pray more than most people I knew. I seemed to worship deeper than most people I knew. Operated in power, was what many would call a successful minister of the gospel. Was blessed in quite a lot of ways. God had been good to me, but within myself, in my relationship with Him, I was always trying really, really hard to do better, and felt like I just couldn't be good enough. And I felt like I was missing something. I felt like I wasn't complete, and I was trying to become complete. And I was trying to attain a perfection, because I thought that was that's what would please God. I used to hear messages early in my Christianity about how God wanted everything. He doesn't want 99%, He wants everything. And so I was always afraid I was only giving 99%. And I was trying to become something and trying to get blessed, and I was trying to find more power, and I was always pushing into something else, and always, you know, felt like I was always, I never could be satisfied. And finally I came to the end of myself where I gave up, and I just laid on the floor and I said, Father, I quit. I still love you, but I just can't, I don't have anything else to give. I don't have anything else to try. I have tried everything every preacher ever brought through our churches, and I'm still not satisfied. And it was like I heard the Lord say, good, are you done now? And my eyes opened up that day. Something happened. Just spiritually, my eyes opened up, and I just saw, or I knew, that everything I'd ever wanted, I had in Him. And everything I was trying to get, I already had. And everything I was trying to be, I already was, because I was a new creation. And it was like this flood of glory came and washed away this refuge of lies. And from that day, things began to change in me, and I began to know and grow in the Lord like I had never had in all the years before. And I want to talk to us this morning, or this afternoon, about a superpower that we have as Christians. My message this afternoon is not what we need to do, what we need to be, or what we need to have. My message is looking at something today and seeing what we have, because if we don't see what we have and who we really are, we're always going to keep trying to be something that we're not and trying to get something that we don't have. And there's a truth that I can tell you this morning. I know, and I pray that the Holy Spirit would manifest that and reveal it to us in a strong way today. But right now, the Bible says in Colossians 2:10, we are complete in Him.
Amen.
About one and a half of you, amen me on that. We are complete in Him.
Amen.
Now, there's a reason that not everybody amen. It's a very common reason. And that reason is eyesight. I want to talk about that this morning. Don't go to 2 Corinthians 3. I want to go to Mark chapter 10. I'm going to change that. In Mark chapter 10, there's a story about a man named blind Bartimaeus. You ever heard of him?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Blind Bartimaeus really wasn't his name. I said Mark 10, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, blind was not his first name.
Right.
And Bartimaeus was really, his dad's name was Timaeus. Bartimaeus identified him as the son of Timaeus. And so he was the blind son of Timaeus, is what they were really calling him, is what they were really saying. He would sit by the roadside and he would beg because he was blind, he couldn't see. And when you're blind and you can't see spiritually, your life is more like a Bartimaeus because you, for one thing, like Pastor was talking about, you beg. The way that you get your needs met, the only way that you have, especially a Bartimaeus in this day, in this particular time in the Bible, the only thing he could do to get his food, to get his water, to get the things that he needed, was to beg for it. He would sit on the road daily and he would be begging with his beggar's garments on. And so when you can't see spiritually, this is something that we want to look at this morning, because spiritually, when we don't see very well, our relationship with God tends to be more of a begging relationship.
Mm-hmm.
It seems like we're always needy. We're always needing some things. And we love the Lord and we believe in the Lord and we're trusting the Lord or trying to trust the Lord. But most of our relating to Him is that God, we have these needs and, you know, we need you to meet our needs. Well, He is the need meter. If the Spirit helps us this morning, if you've got ears to hear this morning in this conference called Streams in the Desert, a time of refreshing, a time of washing, then let the Lord do something to us this afternoon, in these meetings actually, that cause us to, by the time this weekend is over, that we walk away from here and we're walking in another realm, if you will, another dimension of life that Jesus calls the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God. You know, Jesus said that in the book of John 3, he said, unless a man is born again, he cannot, what? See the kingdom of heaven.
Amen.
Now, I used to skim over that. I thought he said, unless a man is born again, he doesn't get to go to heaven when he dies. And while we know that's a part of this whole thing, what he literally said was, unless he's born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven.
Right.
There was something that you cannot see. Now, I know that when I was born again, that's one of the things I noticed. What almost immediately was, as soon as my heart turned to the Lord, I began to see things differently. I began to see and know things and perceive things and really believe and have faith in things that I didn't even know were real before. I began to see and know God in a way that I didn't even think God was that way. I didn't know God was that good. In fact, the reason I got saved was because I didn't think He was that good, but I needed to be on His side anyway. You know, that's the truth.
Yeah.
Anytime somebody preached to me about God, it scared me. Because I didn't think God was that good, and I didn't think He liked me. And after I was born again, and my heart turned to the Lord, I began to fall in love because I saw Him the way He is. How many know what I'm talking about? You start to see things that you couldn't see before, right? You start to like things that you didn't like before. You start to dislike things that you couldn't hate before. Paul said it another way over there in 2 Corinthians 3, and that's what I was going to read, but he said, when the heart turns to the Lord, the veil is removed, and we behold, or we see, the glory of the Lord. So there's something about us born-again new creations of God that we are set apart with this ability to see something that those who are not renewed, those who do not know God, they cannot see these things. That's why there's much ritual in religion, because these are man's best efforts to have some semblance of having some connection with God. And so we have lots of rituals and symbolism in all the religions of the world. And Jesus comes along and reveals the Father to us, and we don't need rituals and symbolism anymore, because we've got the real thing. We see and we know the real thing. In fact, the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 1, John chapter 1, verse 17 says, no man has seen the Father at any time, but the Son, who's in the bosom of the Father, he has revealed him. So think of that. Until Jesus came, nobody had seen the Father at any time. Nobody knew who the Father was. Oh, there were prophets in the Old Testament, and they were inspired, and they heard things, and they were empowered, and they had glimpses of glory. But nobody, none of them revealed the Father to us. Certainly Moses didn't with his law. That was not the revelation of the Father. That's not the heart of the Father. That's not the character or the image of the Father. In fact, the Bible says that Old Testament law just came to show how sinful sin was. All it did, it didn't point to the Father, it pointed to sin. And Jesus came along, the first one walking on earth, and he came and he revealed the Father to us. And he revealed the Father because he was a man filled with the Spirit, and he had no veil between him. Paul said when we turn to the Lord, that veil's removed. Well, Jesus was always turned, and he never had that veil. And when you see the life of Jesus, you're seeing a man walking on earth with no veil between him and the Father. He always could see, and he said, I'm only doing what I see my Father do. He had this super power, and part of it was his eyesight. He could see, he could behold the kingdom of heaven, and he knew it. And he said, that's what I'm doing. I'm just doing what I'm seeing.
Yes.
And that eyesight, that spiritual eyesight that we have, if a man is born again, he can see the kingdom.
Amen.
He can see the kingdom. What that eyesight does is it gives us a different experience in this same world, with its trials, with its tribulations, with its challenges and hardships. But it gives us a completely different experience, kind of like what Jesus said when he said, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Are y'all hearing me? The Bible says, beware of dogs.
Yes, it does.
Amen. It does. So Jesus had this different experience. He walked on the same dusty earth that all the 12 disciples did as they walked side by side. There were 13 men in a boat crossing the Sea of Galilee. Jesus said, we're going to the other side. And then a storm pops up halfway across, and 12 men out of those 13 thought they were going to die. Mm-hmm. And these weren't wimps. Some of them were hardy fishermen that knew about the boats and knew about the sea. And they thought they were going to die because they tried everything they could. It looked like they were going down. And there was one man that didn't think they were going to die. One man thought it was just good sleeping weather. And he had peace about him, even though he was in the same experience, because he saw things differently. Now, this eyesight is something we have. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit was given to us so that we could know, or let me say, so we can see or perceive the things that God has freely given to us. The problem that Christians have, here's where Christians struggle with things, and here's where the Word is working to get the mind renewed, is that we are people that operate in two realms or two kingdoms. There's the kingdom of this world, and there's the kingdom of heaven. And when we're spiritually alive unto God, we have access, or we operate in both of those worlds, both of those kingdoms. We know the things of this physical world, but we also have the ability to know the things of the kingdom of heaven, the invisible world, the Spirit of God. People struggle because their natural eyesight draws their attention to these things. And that's why, years ago, I thought I was not complete in Him, because the things that I saw made it look like I was not. And I couldn't comprehend these. Why? What could these scriptures really mean when it says I'm complete in Him? What do the scriptures mean when it says I'm seated with Him in heavenly places? I wish I was seated there. I'm seated down here on this dusty old earth. What are we supposed to do? Try to imagine this? Is it a figure of speech? What does it mean? But my eyes opened and I saw this is just as real as me standing here in front of you right now. Just as sure as my feet are on this earth right here in Arizona, I am also seated with Him in heavenly places, because I'm not just an earthly man, I am also a spiritual man. Yes. And 1 Corinthians 15 says there's an earthly body and there's also a spiritual body.
Yes.
And if this earthly body were to drop down right now, I would still be alive in this other place.
Yes.
And that other place is where you and I will be forever and ever. And that's where we're at right now.
Amen.
One amen. The key, though, the issue, though, is the vision, the eyesight. Now, Bartimaeus couldn't see. And Bartimaeus, you know, the story, he calls out to Jesus, have mercy on me. Finally, Jesus says, let him come on out here. So they help Bartimaeus, and he drops his beggar's garment because he knows he's not going to have to beg anymore. Something's about to happen. And he goes out to the street where Jesus is, and Jesus asks this question. He says, what do you want me to do for you? What do you want me to do for you? Now, when I read this years ago, Pastor, I said, here's what I said. I said, Lord, with all due respect, I could have figured that one out. Why did you even have to ask? The man was blind, screaming out to you, help me. He's obviously blind coming out there to where you're at. And you're like, what? What do you want? I said, of course you know what he wants. He wants his eyes open. But then I realized a little while later on that it was a good question that Jesus asked, because just because a person is blind does not mean that they're asking to see.
Right.
Because his eyes being open was not the only need that he had. He had the same needs as most everybody else. He needed food. He needed drink. He needed shelter. He needed clothes. He needed some things. So he didn't have to ask for his vision. He could have just asked for those things that pertain to life. He could have just said, Lord, you know, give me enough food to last for a year. Give me some money. Give me something. Give me some way of getting these needs met. Give me a year's supply of something. So I don't have to sit here and beg for that. Give me 10-year supply. However, you know, give me some food, give me some water, give me some clothes. I need lots of things. What do you mean, what do you want me to do? I need lots of things. You want me to read the list? But he didn't go down any list. He said, Lord, I want you to open my eyes. I want to receive my sight. And it's a very good question, and it's a very good answer, because a lot of Christians are not asking the Lord to open their eyes. They're asking the Lord to take care of these needs that we have. Now, here's what Jesus said about these needs that we have. I love how he said this. He said, don't be anxious or worried about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear, etc. Because after these things, the heathen, or those who do not know God, they seek after those things. He says, for your Father knows that you have need of these things. Now, notice that. He said, he knows that you need these things. Mm-hmm. He's not saying to just get used to living without it. He says, your Father knows that you need it. So he said, he wants to take care of that for you. He wants to be your source. He wants to be your supply. He wants to be your life. See, that's how it was in the Garden of Eden.
Yes.
See, we were naked and not ashamed. And when we ate of that tree, we were still naked, but now we're ashamed.
Uh-huh.
Huh? Why did it matter now? Why did it change? Because after we ate of that tree, see, we went independent and we took it upon ourselves to try to become. And so now God is not our source and not our life anymore. Now it's on us. Mm-hmm. Now it's not about God. Now it's about us. Now we're looking at us. It wasn't about us. We didn't care about us. God was our life. God was our source. It didn't matter if we were naked. It didn't matter what we were. Because it wasn't about us. And I want us to just put this in right now. Jesus brought us back home to that. It's not about that now. It's not about you. It's not about how you look. It's not about what you do. It's not about your performance. It's not if you're good or you're bad, because Jesus came and put the axe to the root of that tree of the knowledge of good and evil. It, we're back home to where God is our everything.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness, I got so much to say. I'm going to preach the next couple of new sermons, next couple of sessions here. And so when you're like, I'm spiritually alive, you can see this place that he's brought us back to, this kingdom of heaven. He says, your Father knows you have need of these things, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. These things will be supplied. These things will be taken care of if you can just see the kingdom. If you can see. Now let me kind of illustrate what we're talking about here. Spiritual vision. Without a vision or heavenly vision, people perish. Where there is heavenly vision, people thrive and they live. Jesus came to give us the ability to see and to know and to experience the kingdom of heaven again. He wanted to open our eyes to something. He wanted us to see the kingdom of heaven that God would bring to us. He wanted us to no longer be a prisoner of this world, where we're a victim of its circumstances and its situations, all the hard things that come at us. He wanted to deliver us from that, and the Bible says he translated us out of that kingdom and into the kingdom of light, the kingdom of his Son.
Amen.
But the problem is a lot of people aren't aware of it. They don't see it. We're standing right there and we're trying to go somewhere. We're trying to get something. You know, Jesus said this. Well, let me say it this way. The Bible says, the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Where is it? Righteousness, peace, and joy. Where is it? In. Where is it?
The Holy Ghost.
It's in the kingdom of God. Is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom of God is in the Spirit. That's why Jesus said, the kingdom is within you. They said, when are you going to establish your kingdom? He said, it doesn't come like that. The kingdom is within you. Now think about our gospel here. Jesus died and shed his blood for the remission of our sins, right?
Amen.
Amen? He did.
Amen.
He could have stopped there. You know what? The story could have went this way, that Jesus, the spotless lamb who never sinned, comes and he dies on that cross and sheds his blood and becomes the final sacrifice for our sins. And all of our sins are thereby forgiven by that blood, right? That act has been done. What if he never rose from the dead? The sins would still have been forgiven. We still would have had that sacrifice, the final sacrifice given. We would still be forgiven, and no sins would be counted to us forever again. That would have been enough for that. But the plan was not just to forgive us. He had to do that first, but there was more that he came to do. Because he didn't just die and become the final sacrifice. He became that, and then he rose from the dead. And he defeated death itself. So that we could have new life. He became the first begotten among many brethren. Not only that, when he rose from the dead and he starts showing himself to his disciples again, imagine them seeing him and thinking, this is wonderful. You have won. They killed you and you've come back alive. What are they going to do with you? Kill you again? They can't. Let's go do the stuff now. Now we can follow you. We knew we had the right one all the time. And everything's going to be fine now. And Jesus says, no, we're still not done. I'm not staying. I'm going to go. They're like, why you got to go? Everything's okay now. You won. He says, no, it's not over yet. I got to go. It's better for you guys if I go.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. They're like, we want you here. And he goes, no, you don't understand yet, but you'll see. It's better for you if I go. Because if I don't go, then this Holy Spirit doesn't come to you.
Mm-hmm.
So he didn't just... It was not, wasn't enough. He didn't want to just shed his blood and forgive us our sins. He didn't want to just defeat death for us. He wanted to send the Holy Spirit to us so that we would become new and we would become empowered, so that same spirit that brought him alive from the dead would live in us, and that spirit would be the revealer of truth, and he would lead you and guide you, and he would reveal all things to you. He would open our eyes. To reveal means to uncover or unveil. He would be the power that opens our eyes to the kingdom of God. Now, when that spirit came to earth on the day of Pentecost, what came to the earth? The kingdom of God came.
Amen.
To dwell in the hearts of people. Now, let's look at something here. What I want us to see today is how complete we really are. Father, help us to see that everything that we want you to do, everything we need you to do, is right here in the house in the right now. It's so close to you. It's right under our nose. That everything that brings fullness and joy and everything that you need, it's all right here in the house. See, Jesus said, I'm going to go and I'm going to send the Spirit.
Yes.
Now, before I came here, if I would have told you all last month, living in Florida, that I'm going to send all you, I'm going to send you guys a wonderful package. You guys are going to love it. Just wait for it. And then you hear that, you get that note, you say, hey, Rick's going to send us a package. Oh, hallelujah. Then you all load up and you go to Florida to go get it. When all you got to do is go to the mailbox. Huh?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so why is it then that Jesus sent that kingdom? And it seems like churches everywhere I'm going, Christians, they're trying to go somewhere. They're trying to find something. They're trying to enter into something. They're trying to become something. They're trying to come up higher. But if you could see that by the Spirit today, you would see, you would know that you're already seated with Him in heavenly places. So how much higher do we really want to get? Higher than Jesus? It's not a matter of becoming or going or growing or going somewhere or going into something. It's a matter of seeing something that's in the now. People, there is nobody here or nobody on this earth that's got more going on than you do. That's a good place for an amen. Nobody, if you're born again, there's nobody got more of God than you. The truth is, you find out nobody's more anointed than you are. Paul prayed a prayer and he said, I pray that you'd receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being opened. So you can know the hope of your calling. So you can see this inheritance that he's put in you. So you can know the unlimited and immeasurable power that's both in you and for you who believe. I pray that you would see. Now in 1 Corinthians 3, Paul makes this statement. I preach it all the time, and it's so beautiful, and I love it, and I don't know if I've ever preached without mentioning this passage. I say it so much people think I made it up. And I'm so glad it's in the Bible because it's so big, it's so strong, it's so clear. But it says that all of us with an unveiled face, that means we can see. When the heart turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. And all of us with an unveiled face, we behold, like looking in a mirror, we see the glory of the Lord. And we are changed into that same image. From glory to glory by the Spirit of the Lord. Now that's a big piece to me because it almost sounds blasphemous because it says that it's like looking in a mirror and we see the glory of God. Now I have people get so frustrated by that and they're like, because it sounds like it's almost blasphemous because it sounds like you're trying to say that we're God. Because you look in a mirror and when you see your reflection, you see Him. You see Him, the glory of God. Why is that not blasphemy?
Because we're made in the image of God.
Yeah, right. But to know that you have to see beyond this natural face, don't you?
Yeah.
Because you're not looking at your natural appearance and you're not looking at your performance. You're not looking at your successes and your failures. You're not looking at your flaws or your good points. You're going past all of that. You're looking right past that thin veil of the flesh. And when that veil is removed, you don't see your weaknesses, your struggles, your hurts, your failures, your frustrations, your angers. You don't see all of those things. all you see is the reality of who's in you. And the Bible says the mystery that has been veiled from the ages has now been unveiled in Jesus, and that's Christ in you, the hope of glory. Amen. We're made in His image, and if you go right past that thin veil of the flesh, you'd see who you really are. In other words, you're 1,000 times bigger on the inside than you are on the outside. You're 1,000 times better and more beautiful and more holy on the inside than you look like you are on the outside. And the difference is having spiritual vision, because those without spiritual vision, they can't see past the flesh. That's right. Mm-hmm. And most people can't see past their own flesh. They judge themselves according to their own flesh, to their weaknesses and their successes, and you think that's who you are. All you got to do is have spiritual eyes and look just a little bit further and see who you are. And if you see who you are, the Bible says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you knew who you really were, you would walk like it. It would happen to you. It would play out like it. As he is, so are we now in this world, says the book of John, 1 John chapter 4, verse 17. Why is that so hard for people? Why is it when I say, as he is, so are we? I'm so glad God put that in the Bible. Amen. As he is, so are we. I'm not trying to pump us up. I'm not trying to do positive thinking here. I'm not trying to do some kind of mind thing here. But this is a God who knows the truth, who sees who we really are, and is telling us, you don't even know what a new creation really is. You think it's somebody struggling to trying to get God to help you and take care of you and trying to get God to be pleased with you and trying to get God to just try to get some prayers answered so things can get better for you. I've done so much more than that. I've changed who you are. And like we were singing that song, we're overcomers simply by virtue of what he's done and who we've become in him. We've already overcome and we're not trying to.
Amen.
Because we're already in that place. And when you know that you're in that place, friends, when you know you're in that place, it has a work of righteousness that's called peace. And even if there's a storm in the Sea of Galilee, you have this perfect peace, and that's dominion. That's authority. When you can sleep in peace in the midst of a storm, that's dominion and authority. That's living in another realm. And the effect of righteousness would be quietness and assurance forever. You see, I preach these things because God opened my eyes to the fullness of God a number of years ago. And it wasn't just a good sermon that I thought people would like. This changed everything. It brought me to the place of security and peace, the place where I was comfortable in my own skin, and the place where I was so confident in God, knowing that He had my way, He was my source, and He always had my back, that I walked in a different way. I didn't use my faith to try to say, oh God, don't let that happen to me. I couldn't stand it if you let that happen. God, don't let that. I would walk in this confidence and faith, and while things would crop up and trials, and we all have problems, and I deal with them every other day like you do. But we operate in a whole different way because we're not just earth creatures, we're heaven creatures.
Amen.
And this is how we have our operation. This is how we do our operation in the earth, how we navigate a world where there are some many challenges, where people are not always good at all. Where life is not fair in its circumstances many times. But you can navigate things from a position of absolute, unconditional love and joy and peace. And if you ever really know what that is, I call that heaven on earth. Heaven on earth. There is no better condition than to have absolute love, joy, and peace filling your heart every minute of every day. And when you do that, you walk through this earth in a different way. And what you do find out is your God, who loves you and cares for you like Jesus said he did, is faithful to you. And you find out that he always has your back. Mm-hmm. And things don't always happen the way that you would have, but you're okay with that because you and God have got this thing. And you have this confidence and this assurance with God because now your eyes have been opened and now you know him and now you see him. Hold your hands out like this, would you? I'm going to do something with y'all. This will help us here. Just hold, everybody hold one hand. Now look in the palm of your hand and see, everybody know what an acorn is?
Yes.
Oak tree seed. Look at that, you know, it's got that little brown nut. Look at it in your hand. Can y'all see that? Just imagine it. That little brown nut, little cap thing on it. Acorn. It's the seed of an oak tree. Not very big. Y'all will see it right now, imagine it. Right there in the palm of your hand. Somebody tell me what you see. What do you see? Acorn? Somebody says oak tree. Okay.
Oh, I don't see
it. Well, keep looking. Look at it now. Now do you see it?
Hmm?
Yeah, see? All you do is just keep looking. Because what you first happen, when I first tell you what it is, you look at it and you see an acorn. And people will usually say, well, I see a nut, and I see a seed, I see an acorn, I see a brown thing. And you just look at that brown nut there, and then Josie says, well, I see an oak tree. And it's not an imagination, because in that acorn, there really is an oak tree, right?
Yes.
There really is, but inside that thing, there is an oak tree. All you have to do is just look right past that outward appearance of it, and you see what it really, really is. Because that thing is not just an inanimate object there, just laying there, just to be a nothing there. That thing has a purpose, and it has within it everything necessary to make that oak tree, right? Mm-hmm. Keep looking at it. Because we're not done yet. Keep looking at it. And you can see more than an oak tree there.
Yeah.
What do you see?
A big china hutch.
Okay. Now, we're seeing something that can make furniture.
You bet.
You keep looking at it, and we could be here all afternoon. Yeah, I mean, well, it wouldn't take us that long. It just takes a few minutes. If you keep looking at it, then pretty soon you start. You don't see one oak tree. You think, wait a minute. There's not just one oak tree. This won't just make one oak tree. This could start a whole forest. It's all in here. Mm-hmm. Right? And the truth is, if I were to say, how many trees could this thing end up making, or how many acorns could it produce, you couldn't put a number on it because it's unlimited, see? It's unlimited and it's immeasurable. There's no set amount of number. There's no set limit on how far this thing can go. And we see that over and over in the Bible. And all you had to do, see, all you had to do was just look at it just a little bit longer. Just look at it just a little deeper. And what you found out was you weren't just looking at that nut. You saw something else. There's a tree there, or there's many trees, or there's furniture, or there's houses, or there's a multitude. And that is a good illustration of spiritual vision. All you got to do is just look. And if you look with spirit eyes, when you look at your own life, instead of seeing somebody that needs so much, you'll see somebody that has so much. You'll see somebody that can see in the spirit. And Jesus said, when you do that, you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. And you'll see that, and you'll realize, my goodness, I am so rich. I am so, I'm abounding so much. I have everything I need, and every promise that has ever been made was fulfilled in Jesus Christ. In Him it's yes, and in Him it's amen. And I don't have to beg anymore. I don't have to do anything except know who I am, and as I know who I am, it's my walk with God that causes all these things to work for my good.
Amen.
This is the blessed life. This is what God promised when He said from the Old Testament that in this day of the new, He said goodness and mercy would follow us all the days of our life, and we would abide in the house of the presence of God forever. Are y'all hearing me this afternoon? It's not a matter of once you've got Jesus, you've got the whole thing. Now it's a matter of, will we pay attention? Will we pay attention? Because with the thing with the acorn, the difference was putting attention on it. Because if I would have just let you go, I would have said, you see that acorn? Yeah, okay, then move on. The Bible says in James chapter 1, 22, He talks about those who are hearers of the word, but they're not doing it. They hear the word, but their lives aren't living it out. He said, why do they do that? He says, because they're like a man who looks in the mirror. What did Paul say in Corinthians? He said, we're like looking in a mirror. We see the glory. Mm-hmm. But James said, but there's, it said, you can be the kind of man that looks in the mirror and you behold your natural face in the mirror. And you walk away and you forget what manner of man you are. You can look at that acorn and forget what it really is. You can look at that acorn, you just think it was one little brown nut and forget what it really, really is. And you can look at yourself and look at your own life and you can take a glance at it and you can just walk away and not pay attention to what's really going on and you can forget who you really are. And you start feeling like this other thing. You start feeling like this flesh creature that's trying to please God and appease God and trying to get God to answer prayers. And this wasn't the relationship that Jesus came and did the work for. He came to bring us home to Him, the Garden of Eden again, to where we just walk with Him.
Amen.
And this walk is yours. This is who you really are. I want to wrap this up with giving you this good picture of who we are. See, when we can't see, our lives always seem to be, it seems that we're lacking. When we can't see, we look incomplete. We feel needy. The reason I wrote the book Fullness is because I felt very needy in my spiritual life. Once my eyes opened up, I promise you, I haven't had a day when I felt needy. I don't have days of stress, don't have days of anxiety, worry, frustration. Don't have days of that. If I start to feel that, start to get over into those things, I immediately recognize I'm turning back to this kingdom of this world, and all I have to do is open my eyes and look at the reality that I'm a child of heaven. Amen. And I don't live according to this world, I live according to this kingdom. And see, here's what happens when your eyes are looking at the things of this world. See, that kingdom has a certain weather pattern. There's storms. There's certain things that you cannot help it. You're going to feel frustration. You're going to feel anxiety. You're going to get nervous. There's all kinds of things that are going to happen. Anger is going to happen. You can be a good person. You can love Jesus. But if your eyes are on the things of this world, you're just going to experience those things, right? Mm-hmm. And you can be somebody that doesn't think they're all that good. And you can be somebody that thinks you could do a whole lot better, but you're looking at the things of the kingdom of heaven. And when you look at those things, let me tell you what the weather is in this place that we look at here. The weather here is peace. It's joy. It's comfort, it's safety, it's security. You can always have that. See, when I say that I nearly always walk in peace and joy and in unconditional love, it's not because I'm strong. It's not because I'm real smart or real great. I was struggling, and God opened my eyes, and suddenly I see a whole other realm that I didn't even know was a real thing that I could walk in. I thought it was something that was just too far out of my reach. And I saw this thing, and I thought, my goodness, I'm home. This is my home. This is where I live. This is what he meant when he said that heaven is my home and my citizenship is of heaven and I'm not of this world. This is where I do good. This is where I'm like a fish that got back in the water again now. And you don't have to be great. You just have to be in the weather. Just be in the kingdom, because he that's least in the kingdom of heaven got it going on better than the greatest in the kingdom of this world. That's what Jesus said. Huh? So this is not about you or me being wonderful, trying to be good, trying to get better, trying to get stronger, trying to do it right. Because Jesus came and already did it right.
Amen.
Because Romans 8 says that what trying to be good or keeping the law could not do, because our flesh is too weak, Jesus did for us.
Amen.
Huh? Right. By doing the work for us. And when he did that, he gave us the new life, the Spirit, and he says, now you can see. This is why, if this wasn't better, he would have stayed on the earth and walked along, and he would have held meetings, and every few years, Jesus would have come through here, and we could all have a meeting. But he said, it's better for you. It's not enough. He said, it's wonderful that I've defeated death. But this one that's been with you, me, He's going to be in you. And the things that I do, you'll do them too.
Amen.
Gosh, and even greater.
Amen.
Because I'm going. I'm sending.
Hallelujah.
And here, me and you are the glory of the finished work now. Me and you are the glory of this new covenant. Me and you are the treasures, the trophies of what God did in Christ. And now Jesus is seated at that right hand because he has risen to his rest. He doesn't have to do anything else to complete this. He has done it all.
Right.
The only work that's being done now in the earth in us is the Spirit revealing to us truth. And that's why we have meetings like this, because he wants to open our eyes to the truth of what we have, because he doesn't want us wandering out there in the wilderness trying to find something. He says, when you found me, you've got it all.
Amen.
When my eyes opened up some years ago, I felt like I had been in the Wizard of Oz, but I thought, my goodness, everything I was trying to get, I already had. And I woke up, and I realized that I was home. You see, when you look at your situations, if you look at them on the surface, it's going to look very, very tough and hard, and you're going to have sleepless nights, and you're going to cry yourself to sleep sometime, because it gets hard, and it looks hard. But he said, be of good cheer, I've overcome that. And all we have to do is look with our spiritual eyesight and behold the goodness of God. And realize that God is bigger than all of this. Mm-hmm. And I've overcome all of that because he overcame for me.
Amen.
And I promise you that's right. Right now, right this very day, he has made it. So from now on, you never have to have another day of stress, worry, fear, anger, frustration, a sense of lack or incompleteness. Because we are complete in him.
Yes. That's right.
It's just, let us see. Let's look. My message to you is, this is what you've got. You can see. This is the advantage you have. This is what makes you different than people in the world.
Yes.
You know, when Jesus saw, we're going to the other side, 12 men, what they saw was, we're going to die here. And Pastor, every time I've heard somebody preach that, they relate us to those 12. They say, oh, we all feel like that. We all do just like those 12. We're all just like Peter. And I'm like, wait a minute. Why are we got to be like these unregenerated, unborn again, unrenewed souls that didn't get it? And here's one that could see. And we're the ones that got the Spirit. We can see. We don't relate to those 12. We relate to him.
Amen.
We're the ones that have peace. We're the ones that have faith. We're the ones that have confidence. We're the ones that have joy. The storm was a bad storm, but it doesn't matter to us because we're going somewhere.
Yes.
That's right.
Come on. Y'all hearing this?
Amen.
Gotcha. It's a matter of seeing. So I want to finish it up with this. In the book of Revelation, chapter 5, if you want to go there real quick, we'll wrap this up. Thank y'all for giving me your time this afternoon. Are y'all hearing anything?
Amen.
Are y'all seeing anything?
Yeah. Amen.
In Revelation, chapter 5. Now, as I read this, I want to remind us of something. Now, where'd my water go? That in the book of Isaiah, and I would have read it, but we don't really have time. Okay. Or it would drag out if I did. In the book of Isaiah, he said, the people and the seers, their eyes are covered, they're blinded. And because of that, they live a hypocrisy. Their mouths say one thing, but their lives aren't lining up. And he says, so I'm going to fix this. I'm going to do a marvelous work and a wonder. Now, here's what he could have said, but he didn't say. He could have said this. He says, I'm going to fix these people. He says, I'm going to punish them so much harder than I ever had, because what I've done hasn't worked. And I'm going to punish them so hard that they're finally going to cry uncle. They're finally going to say, that's enough. And they're finally going to straighten up and be good. But he didn't say that, because that doesn't work. He could have said, I'm going to send the prophets and bring such shame and condemnation on them that they feel so bad. Because the problem is they must not feel bad enough about it. But once they feel bad enough and I bring so much shame on them, then they're going to change. But he didn't say that either. He said, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a marvelous work and a wonder. I'm going to open the eyes of the blind that cannot see.
Amen.
I'm going to cause the deaf to hear that book, and they will increase their joy. The humble will rejoice, and those who walked disorderly shall know the way of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I'm not going to do it by punishment. I'm not going to do it by shame. I'm going to open the eyes of the blind. He said that blindness was like a book that is sealed. He used that symbol. He said it's like a book that is sealed. Blindness. There's something in there, but nobody can see it. Healing the blindness would look like this. But he says, the vision of all is like a book that is sealed. But I'm going to unseal it. I'm going to open their eyes. And he says, the blind will see out of obscurity and out of the darkness. And when I cause them to see, that's when it's all going to change. And when he sent Jesus, that's what happened. He gave us the ability to see the things of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And that was going to change us. The ability to know the ways of the Father, the glory of the Father, to know who we are and what's really going on here. That would bring the joy. That would cause the disorderly to walk in the ways of God. Are you getting this? It's not by trying harder. It's not by being better. It's not by praying more, praying louder necessarily. It's not by doing anything except seeing. This is how free this is. This is how free this work really is. All we have to do is look with the eyes that he's now given us, the ability to see. Because he said he was going to do it. And with Jesus, he did it. That's why Jesus said, unless a man is born again, he cannot see it. When the heart turns to the Lord, the veil's removed and we see it. So here we are. In Revelation 5, I want to finish it up here. Revelation 5, he describes it. This work of Jesus. Now, this vision that John's seeing, in chapter 4, he's describing, he says, there's a throne, I saw a throne, and one seated on the throne, and he's describing all the glory of it, and how awesome it is, and just think of this, here's every God is the fullness of him that filleth all in all, and this is everything that would fulfill the heart and cry of mankind, and all the ails and ailments of man. And he says, verse 1 of chapter 5, and I saw a book in the hand of him who sat on the throne. And there was writing on the inside and out, and it was sealed with seven seals. There's that sealed book again that Isaiah talked about. What does a sealed book mean? It means blindness. He says the book was sealed, and I saw an angel with a loud voice saying, who's worthy to open the book? To take the book and open the seals thereof. He says, but no one was worthy to open that book and break the seals. In other words, everybody's still blind. And John says, and I wept much. Because nobody was found worthy to take that book and to open the seals of it. Why was he crying? Because here's everything. Here's the fullness of the glory of God. There's a river of life in this place. There's trees that produce fruit 12 months later. There's no hunger. There's no thirst. Everything, all fullness is here. But nobody can see it. It doesn't do any good, see, if you can't see it. You'll still do without, even though everything is yours. God wants us to see it today, because if you can't see it, then you won't partake. Because remember, there was a housekeeper named Hagar in Abraham and Sarah's house, right? And they kicked Hagar out one time. And her boy went out into the desert, and they got so far out there, and there was no water. They had no water, so they were about to die of thirst, and her boy was about to die immediately. So she puts him under a little bush, and she walks away. And a mama, she wants to be there, right, do all she can. But finally, she says, I can't stand to watch him die right in front of my eyes. And she walks away from him, and she cries out to the Lord. And the Bible says that the Lord opened her eyes.
Yes.
And she saw a well of water.
Mm-hmm.
She didn't cry out and say, God, give me some water. And so God then dug a well for her to drink from. It doesn't say that. It says that he just opened her eyes and she saw one.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That means it was always there, but she couldn't see it.
Right.
Oh, come on, somebody.
Right. Amen.
And that's my message this morning. There's a well. And Jesus tells us in Revelation 20, he says, tell everybody. Tell anybody that's thirsty to come and drink.
Yes.
Don't tell them there's no water. Don't tell them You know, I go to churches and they'll sing how dry and thirsty we are, and Lord, please pour something out for us because we're about to dry up here. And I'm like, Jesus, just tell them if they're thirsty, let them drink because it's here. Amen. But if you can't see it, you're going to be thirsty because you're not going to be partaking of what's right there in front of you. Are you listening to me? Huh? And we got a lot of people that are really thirsty and hungry when Jesus said, listen, you drink of the water that I have, you'll never thirst again because it will be a well that springs up and it never stops.
Hallelujah.
We'll always have the supply. Huh? But they can't see it. John said, I wept, I cried. Because nobody can open the book. It doesn't do any good that God is so good. God is good and the work is finished in Jesus and everything's done. But if you can't see it. And then he said, one of those in and around the throne touched my shoulder and said, don't cry. Because the Lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed to open that book.
Amen.
What's the open book means? It means eyesight. It means the blind will now see.
Yes.
They will now see the glory of God.
Hallelujah.
No man had seen God at any time, but the Son who's in the bosom of the Father, he has revealed him to us.
Yes.
Jesus would reveal the Father to us. We would know that he's altogether lovely. We would know that he's altogether good. It would give us vision. We'd be able to see what we never could see before. No man had seen God at any time, but now we would see.
Amen.
And it goes on and it says, he took that book out of the right hand of him that sat on the throne. He took that book to open the seals. And the Bible says those of us who are in and around the throne says we sing a new song. I believe it symbolically speaks of us. We'll preach that tonight. Just got to come back and get the rest of that part of it. But it says we sang a new song. And the new song said, you are worthy to take the book. Would y'all stand up? The new song said, you're worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for you were slain. And you've redeemed us unto God out of every kindred and tongue, tribe and tongue, and people and nation.
Hallelujah.
You've made us kings and priests unto our God, and we shall reign in the earth.
Yes.
Amen.
Not just sometime after we die, but right here and now, because now we see. See, fresh vision gives you a fresh song. When you see the truth, it puts a different song in your heart. It puts a different sound in you. Are you hearing me on that back row? Huh? Why did they sing a new song? Because they must have been singing a different one before that. They had to be singing a different song before they could see. What was the song they were singing before? I don't know, but it was probably something along the lines of Barely Get Along Street Next to Grumble Alley and Watch Me Struggle Valley and Can't Wait to Die and Get Out of Here.
Yeah.
Didn't know. He said he brought the kingdom to us.
Yes.
Whatever they were singing. Maybe it's something about the host of hell advancing and our strength is almost gone, but I hear the master faintly calling, hold the fort. I don't know, but whatever they were singing, the gloom, despair, and agony on me, whatever they were singing before, Jesus opens their eyes.
Yes.
And now we have a new song.
Amen.
Now we see.
Amen.
Father, I give you praise this afternoon.
Hallelujah.
And I thank you for the saints that are here within the sound of my voice. And I thank you for the supernatural power of your Holy Spirit to do what only your Spirit can do, reveal the goodness and the glory, the unconditional love, the power and the fullness of the Father to us. Let everyone within the sound of my voice have the impartation of the Spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of you, that people stand here and they behold with spirit eyes the glories of the kingdom of heaven. Right now where you're at, people, won't you just stand there and just be aware with the eyes of your understanding, with the eyes of your spirit. Just be aware of the reality of where you abide right now in that kingdom of heaven. Just be aware of the reality that you have come home in Jesus. Be aware of the reality that when he raised up and was seated at the right hand of the Father, you're right there in him. That's where you live. That's where you abide. You see, Colossians 3 says, we are dead and our life is hid, veiled, it's covered with Christ in God. And it says that, but when Christ, who is our life, is revealed, you also will be revealed with him in glory. Because we see who he is, we see who we are. Who is he today? He's altogether lovely. And Lloyd and Debbie were saying this, but I got to close with this. He loves you unconditionally. See that.
Amen.
And don't see anything less. Because if you don't see that, you're going to feel condemned. You're going to feel insufficient, not good enough. You're going to feel like your faith is too small. See that he's altogether lovely, and he loves you unconditionally.
unconditionally. That he loves you. He loves you just like you are. He loves you just like you are. In fact, your weakness is precious to him because he chose the weak on purpose so that it would just magnify how good and glorious he really is in these weak and imperfect people. That makes God even better. So because of that, I'll glory in my own weakness, because in him I stand in perfection. Take that one, Mr. Accuser of the Brethren. You can point out all my faults and flaws, and you would be right about all of them, but it don't matter.
That's right.
I am blessed and favored because of the goodness of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I see it. My eyes are open. Give God a praise, guys. Hallelujah.